I'm sitting here with Dave Cash, who's superintendent of Chickasha Public Schools. I almost said Locust Grove Public Schools, just because you were there for so long, and that's why I worked with you. And so Dave has kind of been a guinea pig for a lot of what we do, and typically volunteers to jump off cliffs and try new things.
Absolutely.
And so one of those things that he has done, and a lot of people have heard about, is their personalized learning campus, or what we've called here at OPSRC, Momentum Schools. And so how that came about is we started working with Carol, actually, who is our director of teaching and learning. And she heard about a school in Salt Lake City, went and visited, saw that it was really good, run by a gentleman named Ken Grover. And so she had people from the Resource Center go visit. So we went out and visited, and the campus is absolutely amazing. And so when I was there, the first thing I did was called Dave and said, hey, you guys should really look at this. Yep. and check it out and see what it's about. And so, Dave, and you had a few people from your school visit, right?
Yeah, Michelle Ponticos, our high school principal, and Julie Badgett-Sin, our board president, and myself went out. And really, I'm a skeptic by nature. And so I think my exact words to you is I'd have to see it to believe it. And that's one of those things we went out and saw, and in the first 5 minutes knew this is something we wanted to do. So
let's talk like key pieces of it, right? Like, mm-hmm. So I think the language that, and in fact, Carol and some of the people on the team here could probably speak about this better than I could, but key things for him are path, time, pace, place.
Right.
But I think the key pieces of the school, so when you go into his school, this is actually a high school in Salt Lake City. And so key pieces are autonomy for students, right? Like, so they kind of right. have freedom when they're going to show up. Now, that doesn't necessarily, unless they have like an elective at a brick and mortar, a VOTEC class,
right,
or maybe concurrent class, they have kind of autonomy to choose like when they come and how they come. There's not really a set schedule. How's that work?
Yeah, in Chickasha, we're a little bit different. It's ours is really a combination of the brick and mortar and the personalized learning. So their electives are all brick and mortar for us. So, but the student can show up anywhere between 7 in the morning and stay till 5 in the evening. So, they do have that ability. It's kind of neat to see students' faces at first because there is no such thing as a tardy because you show up, you clock in, you still have seat time, but it's one of those things that we criminalize in the traditional school that is illogical because in the real world, if I've got a dentist appointment, I go do it in the morning and then I go to work and I just let people know. So it's kind of funny once you start treating these kids like adults and making them responsible, 95% of them rise up to the occasion.
And so and what I found interesting about both the school in Salt Lake City, which is Innovations Early College High School, and your campus is when you show up, you'll see kids walking the hall. There might be somebody on a cell phone, which in a traditional school right. would never happen. But they make the phone call, and just like you at work, you'd step out of the office,
right.
take your phone call, step back in the office, go back to work. You see kids that are super focused, even though they've been given that freedom. And so, and I know one of the things that people talk about a lot are, one of the things people talk about is that our schools kind of look backwards. We're preparing people for a job that hasn't existed for some time. And when you look at the school in Salt Lake City and some of the things that you're doing in Chickasha, it looks more similar to what people might do in an office today.
Well, if you go talk to I'm on the Economic Development Committee in Chickasha and have spoke to the Chamber of Commerce and those kind of things. And you talk to business people, they will tell you our kids are – lacking in skills, the soft skills, and just basic responsibilities because we spoon feed them the whole way. The traditional model is very rigid and a kid doesn't really have to think. They don't have to plan their day. It's planned for them. And so they get out of school and all of a sudden they have this freedom of making choices and they make a lot of bad choices. So why not get that taken care of in school? And we've had a few students we've had to sit down and say, you're not logging in the kind of time you need to. You're not being responsible and redirect them, but that's been very few students.
So that's one of the pieces is kind of that autonomy. Students kind of, there's some freedom about how and when they go about doing that work. And then I would say another key piece is probably the mentoring, right? So that's a big part of the model. Can you talk about what that's been like for your school? How are you guys doing that?
I'll be honest with you. I think it's because when you look at the curriculum in Salt Lake City and you look at the students there, and I've talked to the students there, there's nothing novel about what we're doing. The content and the curriculum is what it is. The piece that makes this different is the mentoring piece, in my mind. And the students, our students would tell you that, and our teachers would tell you that. They have an adult that they check in weekly with that talks about their progress that week. But then they also talk about their goals for the week, but then their goals in general. What is your goal in life? What are you trying to accomplish? When you're done in Chickasha High School, what are you going to do, and how are we helping you get there? And so those are conversations that never take place in a traditional high school.
I never had any of those conversations in high school.
We put one counselor for every 450 students in Oklahoma, and we say, go counsel, except you've got to do the testing, and you've got to do X, Y, and Z, the schedules. And so your counselors will never have those conversations. But now we've got an adult that's not a parent that's having conversations about college or career tech or just their life goals. And so you get kids that are more focused. Our traditional teachers, the ones in the elective areas, have already seen a difference between our PLC students and our traditional students.
So PLC, your personalized learning campus. So
right.
They've seen a difference between that student and your. So what's the difference?
One month in, they say those students are better organized and better prepared for class than a traditional student. They come in with the end in mind. They're already starting to think of what is the purpose of this class? What knowledge am I trying to gain here? And they're readily attacking that because that's what they do at the PLC building. They are enrolled in courses there, and it's on you. You know, ultimate responsibility. Education is the most personal thing that you can do, except we try to make it where everyone else is accountable but the student. In personalized learning, the student is accountable for the progress.
So I guess another key piece of personalized learning is obviously the competency base. So a student can move according to competency instead of age or grade or,
right,
or year. And then I guess the other piece here is kids can work online kind of how they want. So when I went to Salt Lake City for the first time, I talked to a student who they had done all of their math, basically all their high school math in their freshman
right.
year, and then we're going to start sciences next. I guess they have some freedom about how they tackle, but do you – So, but there's a is there like a pacing for, you know, you need to earn this many credits a month,
yeah,
or how does that work?
We do it. It's basically a quarter credit per class per 9 weeks is just the minimum. That'd be a traditional pace. We've got 5 weeks in, we've had kids earn an entire course credit already. So you've got some kids that absolutely test out and move quicker. You've got others that are behind. But they know what the end goal is. And so we have more kids working at home at night in this model than you would a traditional model. Kids that would never do homework before are doing homework because they know the end is just, I know what I have to get accomplished to complete this class. I know what knowledge I need. It's a neat process. The students picked it up quicker than the adults. Our teachers struggled with this idea of the student can work on just math all day today.
And in whatever room they want to.
Right.
It doesn't matter what teacher's room they're in because curriculum is online, and then if they have questions,
right,
they can go find.
Just go sit down with your teacher. You'll see kids there at 7 a.m. because they know that one of our math teachers is there at 7 a.m. There's not as many students there. So you'll have kids that need one-on-one help that are showing up at 7 a.m. to school, and our traditional school starting at 8:30. So it is a – when you put the kid in charge of their own education, you explain it just like that, and then we remove all those things that have kept kids from going as quick as they can, and quite honestly, the teachers, it's pretty remarkable.
So are there any other key pieces of this that I'm missing?
Well, I think the idea that the student can pace themselves and they are finished with the class when they're finished with it. So you transcript it. That student that was 5 weeks in, it finished a class, we transcripted it then. And so now you just enroll them in the next class. I believe that was a trig class. So now it's on to calculus. So that student finished that year's worth, that year-long course in 5 weeks. Now they're taking calculus. Traditional, that student would be sitting there. Even if they worked ahead, they would be sitting there till the semester break, basically spinning their wheels.
So people who are watching, or maybe people who will be listening to this podcast later, because we have some people watching live, we have some people who will be listening to this in podcast version. One of the questions that a superintendent will have is just say, hey, wait, back up. What are we even talking about here? You're doing personalized learning. So let's start from the beginning. I talked about how I went out. I called you. You went out. So let's talk about your steps. How did this get started? So who went and visited from your school, and then what was that process
like? So high school principal, board president, myself looked at it. We gathered as much information as we could about what the model was doing in Salt Lake City. I'm a bottom line person. So when I went out and looked, I mean, I want to know what your ACT scores are, you know, your pass rate, what are you doing for kids that are struggling? What are you doing for the kids that are advancing? And when you look at it, it sells itself. I mean, kids are in charge of their own education. And those kids there are not struggling. They're exceeding what the traditional student in Oklahoma or anywhere else in the United States is doing. So we looked at the results. This is something we want to be a part of. The next process for us was educating our school board. This is so different. This is digital curriculum. It's not online. And that's a big mix-up for a lot of people. A lot of people look at this and they say, well, this is just a virtual school. No, it's not. It is a blended model. The digital curriculum, but you've got a teacher for math, you've got a teacher for English, teacher for science, teacher for social studies. You go to them on a daily basis if you need to. We might have some of our students not work with those teachers but once a week, and we might have some work 4 or 5 times a day. It just depends on the student need. It's all around what can we do to help this student be successful.
Right, and really, teacher plays a big role. I mean, it's just like any classroom. That student's going to be successful because they have a good teacher. And in this model, that student gets more one-on-one time with the teacher and small group access.
One of the kids said they get more attention and more teacher time, so to speak, in this model than they've ever had in their life.
And one of the best quotes about that I heard was Michelle Ponticos, your principal, said she heard a kid say, I feel like the teacher doesn't teach the subject they teach. They teach me.
The student, yeah.
Which was pretty powerful.
Yep.
So you guys decided to do it. So you educate your board. Did Ken come out and talk with your board? Or
He came to the board meeting, which we approved it, but he actually talked to one of my board members for about 2 hours. I had one board member, very due diligence, 3 pages full of questions. And then at the end, he called me and said, hey, I'm in on this. This makes sense.
So the general reaction, because I know you had principal, you went, your curriculum, Mickey went, head of curriculum, right? So what was the general reaction from those people?
This is a no-brainer. Once you see it, and I've had, I don't know how many people have come through Chickasha, and we're in the infancy of this. We're not nearly as far as we're going to be. But every person that's come through, I make a point to walk them through the building and then I walk them through our high school. Because our high school, our traditional high school, is like any other high school in Oklahoma or in America. And I say, pay attention to the student engagement piece. So when we walk in, no one knows we're coming. It is just a normal day. We walk through, and 95% of our kids in the PLC or building are engaged actively in their learning.
So let's go through this then piece by piece, because you're using Ken's model, but it probably looks a little different in Chickasha. You're a rural school, and so what were your steps? So I know you had a building that you could put it in. So it's not something you forced people to do. It's not something.
Yeah, completely voluntary. So we presented it to our students, gave presentations to our students and our parents, and at the end just describe what it was. If it's something you're interested in, sign up for it. If it's not, stay in the traditional model. So we had 150 approximately of our 700 students that enrolled. After the first week, I think next year we'll probably be at the 300 mark, because we had so many students. Once they saw it with their own eyes, kind of like me, as skeptical, is this just the latest, greatest, you know, fly-by-night education, you know, trend. But it's really not. When you boil it all down to, it's student engagement, it's time on task, it's all those things that research tells you students learn best.
And so you present it to them, this is a school that we're starting within our school. It's a high school that you can go to. And so we've got a building set aside for it. And so basically you're going to be autonomous. Your curriculum will be online. It's digital, but it's a blended model.
Right.
Where you're going to be taught. You can kind of choose how you come and when you come a little bit here. So you get some freedom. And then you can kind of move at your pace. So
correct.
So let's talk about structure then. So outside, so you were lucky enough that you had a building that you could,
right.
you could just say, hey, we're going to use this. It was a freshman building, right?
Right.
Used to be. So how many classrooms in there?
Six.
And so you have six teachers, is that?
I have five teachers. Well, actually, there's six and a little mini computer lab. Houses maybe 13 computers. And a little teacher's area as well. So they can, there is an escape route for teachers. So when they need a break, they can go in there. And it just looks like any, you know, ordinary space. But we also have a student lounge. Because you'll have students that are in there working, and they'll work for two straight hours on something. And guess what? They also need a break, too.
Right.
So they'll walk in there and go get them a bag of pretzels or something and drink a Diet Coke and, you know, spend 10 minutes and decompress and then go back and get after it.
So you have that building, and then you have five teachers. Do you have tutors? Do you have?
We do have tutors. We have some teachers from middle school where we're able to free them up to do some tutoring. We've also hired a tutor that's a college student there at USAO. And they can be assigned to any student. So the math teacher knows that Johnny is struggling with whatever it is, Algebra 1. They can say, you know, hey, Johnny, at 10 o'clock every day, you're going to meet with the tutor for 20 minutes. And that's just scheduled in. So it sounds loosey-goosey. It's really not. It's very structured when you get to the needs of the students. The students, if they're flying along, remove as much structure as you can, let them go as far as they can. If they need it because they're struggling and the kid isn't going to come in for help, great. Then if they're not going to do that, assign that tutor. All right, 10 o'clock, you will be there every day. So
is the ratio for you since you started, it's kind of voluntary and you only have 150 kids, is not that different. But let's say you jump to 300 students. Is that going to require a lot more teachers, or how does that work?
No, ideally you're 25 to 30 students per mentor teacher. Every student assigned a mentor teacher, but then they also have their teachers of their subject. So two different things.
Okay, so now we kind of have a view, everybody. You have a couple of tutors. You have that computer lab, and then you have five teachers in rooms.
Right.
And so those kids come in, and what does a day look like for them? They come in, and they can work where they want, but, I mean, do they get regular instruction? Do they? I mean,
yeah, and on some case, every teacher has what they call a seminar. And our Algebra 1 teacher, again, use them for example, if they're working on Pythagorean theorem, they will post in the student lounge, hey, at 10 o'clock this morning and at 1:30 today, I'm doing a brief lesson on this. And so if you're struggling with that, be there. But it's up to the student. They know if they're on that or not, if they're struggling with that or not. But the teacher also knows, they track where everybody's at. So they know if I've got 15 kids on this one, they'll just email the students, hey, you need to be at one of these two sessions.
So, and that's kind of like a traditional lecture that
right.
might be in a classroom. I'm going to get that larger group lesson. And then, but I also, I mean, there are smaller groups I can be a part of, and then the one-on-one and the work with a tutor, right?
Right. Our seminars are no more than 10 students. That's why they do multiple, and they invite them specifically. But we've had as many as 30 show up because they needed that one lesson. And so the teacher then has to kind of juggle their time a little bit more. So we're working out the kinks on that a little bit and knowing how to make sure it's still individualized.
And then in your computer lab or extra room, you have a tutor station in there. Mm-hmm. And then when I was talking with Michelle, your principal, she mentioned that you have teachers who have an off hour who come over and spend time in there too working
right.
with students, right?
Yeah, and that's every room has its own feel. Some of them are more collaborative in nature, and so they're going to be a little bit louder. Some of them are very quiet. Some of them, the lights are on, some of the lights are off. That that computer lab area, if a student knows they want absolute dead quiet to concentrate on something, that's where they go. And so you always find a handful of students in there, and they're absolutely hooked up on something they need to concentrate on.
So you guys present it to the board. They approve it. You have your facility. You have your teachers. So what was, I mean, what comes next? And you know, if I was looking at doing this, you know, what, you know, you obviously, so you partnered with us here at the Resource right. Center. And so, but I mean, just for you internally, what were next steps? What were things you guys were working on?
A lot of it was the, how do we structure? We met with every set of parents and student ahead of time to establish the culture of what this is. This is not a happy-go-lucky fun time. You know, this is school. So setting the expectations, setting the culture. So we met with every student in the spring that signed up for it with their parents. They scheduled a time, met with counselor, assistant principal, and their mentor teacher. So that was a lot of hours and a lot of legwork there. Also is just getting the procedures down, the sign-in, sign-out procedures, those kind of things, because it needed to be adapted to what works for us. And then, quite honestly, it was just getting the building ready, making sure the wireless will handle all the loads, making sure we have enough Chromebooks in there for every student, enough desktops, and so on.
So let's talk about technology real quick, because anytime we talk about technology in relation to education, and so we don't want to call this online education. We're calling this a digital curriculum.
Right.
That's a blended model, because it's very important to draw the line. But you need devices, and you need them in abundance, and you need Wi-Fi. So, I mean, did you guys have to buy very expensive equipment, or, I mean, what was your, how did you navigate that?
Chromebooks. We put some Chrome bases in there as well. We had about 10-15% of our students brought their own device. They wanted their own laptop or whatever from home, which is great. But the rest, we just want to make sure we had enough Chromebooks where every student can check one out, take it home, you know, work from home.
So you used just Chrome devices, yeah. And that's worked just fine for you. So
perfect.
Inexpensive Chrome devices are
$200 a piece.
Great, that's, right? Easy to replace when they're broken, right? Not a lot of money,
right?
And then I think also what's great about this model is people tend to think that the technology is the center of this, but really it's the student and that teacher that are at the center of that.
The right? relationship, which is everything in this. The teacher, the mentor-mentee relationship is very powerful. You can see that with the student and the teacher. They will talk. They're very passionate about it. Our teachers are working harder and longer hours than they ever have and have more satisfaction in loving it more than they've ever had, you know, experienced as well as a teacher.
So, I mean, because what I think about this that's neat about when I went to Salt Lake City for the first time, I go out to Salt Lake City, I start going through the classrooms, and I look around MacBooks, iMacs everywhere. What they had was really nice, but what I found out very quickly was that was just
overkill.
And it was just what their IT department recommended, right? They just went with what they could get. Yeah. You go in a room, it's just a projector and a screen, and then they didn't even have smart boards or interactive technology. It was all about that teacher-student relationship like you were talking about. What I found so... You know, when you talk to the student, to the teachers in Salt Lake City, one of the things that I thought was so impressive is they say, you know, when I taught in a traditional classroom, I was shotgunning information to 30 students at a time. Right. And I knew, you know, we talk about differentiation all the time. I knew I'm missing students because I've got students who aren't, you know, on level, and I've got some students who are just bored because they're far above that. And they said they always felt, you know, like dissatisfied at the end of the day, not with their profession or whatever, but just the fact that, like, I know I'm missing kids, but when you talk to them about this model, they're like, I know that I am touching every student, and I'm right where they need me to be.
If you think about it, any principal, superintendent, teacher, parent will sit back and think about the model that proliferates Oklahoma.
Nailed it.
It's flawed. Because you can't stand up in front of and teach 30 kids on one topic and that topic be where every student needs that information. I don't care what the subject area. So back to math, I'm teaching math. 25% of those kids already know that. Now, they're the ones that just give me the work, let me get it done, give me my A, moving on. And their parents are quite happy with that because they don't know any better. Hey, my student's a straight A student. yeah, the material is being covered. They already know. They knew it when they showed up. Then you've got that percentage, 40, 50% that's right in the middle, and they're on pace, and hey, that's great. And then you got that 25% that they're in pre-algebra. It's where they need to be. They don't have the basis to be successful. So those 25% are going to be discipline problems, because I'm not going to look stupid as a teenager in class. I'm going to try to control what's going on. I can't be. I've got to be too cool to learn this. That's my way of dealing with it. The top end kids just going to sit there quietly, give me the work, and then they're going to brag about they know all this, and then make fun of the ones in the middle that are struggling with it. That's not a very good model. Here, everybody's where they need to be. And so every student in a room might be at a different place, and that's okay. They're where they need to be. So they have the ability to be successful and also the ability to be challenged. And your upper end kids struggle the most with this, because they're used to getting everything correct and give me my A and I'm moving on. I'm the best. I'm the smartest kid in this class. Well, all of a sudden now they're being challenged. And that is actually where it's kind of funny. The lower end kids, your middle kids, they move seamlessly into this model. Where you struggle is your higher end kids, because they're not used to putting forth the effort and the struggle to get the information, because they've never been challenged.
That's crazy. I mean, that's the exact opposite of how you think it would be. You would think.
You'd think the low-end kids would struggle and not be focused or whatever. And I can promise you, I've been in the room and I know some kids individually, and I know how they are academically. And before, they would be the one acting the fool because they're behind. Now they're just hooked up and they're finding success. So for the first time, they're finding academic success in a classroom environment that they've never experienced before, and they're eating it up.
So let's talk a little bit about that, because I know one of the things that people probably think when they hear something like this is, great, you took the top 150 students in your school, and you said, hey, we're going to try this new model and watch it sell to success. But, I mean, that's not what you did. You guys took all comers, right?
Yep. And so special needs students, ELL students, gifted students, it's across the spectrum.
So, I mean, I think that's really powerful when you see that, hey, it's not that we just took our high performers, but we took everybody, and we're finding success here.
Yeah. You actually got kids, when they advance quickly, that will take more concurrent classes. And we're going to see that on some ends.
Okay, hold on, though. So let's stop right there. So you mentioned concurrent. So not only are you – so you have kids going through K-12 classes, blended digital curriculum. And then, so you have students who are taking concurrent, and then do you have students taking VOTEC too? Yes. Is that all still?
Yeah.
I can still play sports if I'm. So absolutely. Talk about how all of those work.
That's why Ken and I had this great conversation. We were talking about this model, and he stepped back and he said, Dave, you have a better model than we do in Salt Lake City, because we have to bus our kids for band, we have to bus them for football, and they're going to other schools. They're going to a variety of four different high schools. You have that tradition of the football, the basketball, the academic team, the band, the choir, all those things, and your kids just go do that and then come back into this model.
Yeah, so they don't have to bus it. They can walk right out of the building into the next building, do that.
But they have to be responsible enough to know that at 9:05, I need to be in ag class, or I need to be in choir.
So and then talk about how concurrent works then. What's that look like?
Actually, it's freed up our kids. In a traditional model, most people that schedule will tell you concurrent's really difficult because their hours don't line up with the traditional school. And so they might miss their first 2 hours of the day, but it would just be for one college class. And so it's kind of hard to schedule. Here, they can take night classes. Those all count towards hours, towards your seat time. Or they can go all morning and go to OCCC. Is about 30 minutes from us. They can go right up the road to USAO and spend all morning there. Take as many classes as you can. And so our juniors and seniors that are concurrent kids, we encourage them to take all they can. We have a financial arrangement with USAO, so we're paying for it. But this model allows those kind of things to happen.
Well, that's amazing. So they get free college classes.
Right.
And because of the way the model works, and because, the way that it fits, I can take my K-12 high school classes, and I don't mean K-12 the company, I mean
right.
But I can take my high school courses, you know, when it fits for me, because that's it's so flexible, and then I can go do concurrent.
Yep. Build concurrent however you need to. We actually have 12 hours of college concurrent that's taught there in Chickasha from Redlands. So we have an agreement with Redlands. We also have the agreement with USAO, but we also have some that go to OTRIP. So it's just whatever fits your schedule.
So for people listening, because they hear all of this and they go, okay, but, I mean, so Chickasha, kind of a bigger town in Oklahoma, and so you probably have a lot of, you have a lot of luxuries maybe that I don't in, you know, wherever it might be. So it, how is it, is this possible for rural schools to jump
absolutely.
Into?
Oh, absolutely. This is... There's no, you're not, and you're basically bound by your bandwidth. You need some bandwidth, and outside of that, if you've got that, then the sky's the limit. Every model should be a little bit different based on the community, demographics, what's important to that community. But concurrent is available to anybody, and career tech is also available. So we actually have an agreement with a career tech. If our students get their baseline high school credits done by the time they're a junior in high school, they can go all day to career tech. So they can get multiple industry certifications, therefore preparing them to go make money when they get out.
Oh, that's great. So now let's throw a monkey or a wrench into the works here. You know, so let's talk about negatives. So there are always going to be, people are going to say this is not for everybody. So every student, this is not going to be for every student.
Right.
So we talked about, you talked earlier about structure. You know, they don't have to plan their day because their entire day is planned for them. But what about those students who really do rely on that structure? So what do you do there?
Well, we have the traditional model still, and I think there will always be a need for that. But it's not, this can work for any student. This can work for your kid with ADHD. It can work for your kid that's special needs. It can work for your gifted. But it's also, it's really geared toward the kid, not what their abilities are academically. And we have always grouped kids together by their academic abilities. This has nothing to do with that. Any one of those kids can be successful in this model. It's really down to the kid. You know, are they going to take ownership of their own education? Is this important to them? And those are the things that we're, that is the change for the student. Get out of that, everything is done for me, I'm spoon-fed the information, whether I want it or not, and to an ownership of the education, this is the information I need.
So, I mean, there has to be an advantage here then. I mean, as far as students go, I can work at my own pace, and then at a certain point, when I have conquered those basic high school credits, now I can kind of specialize my education. Like, what am I passionate about?
Right.
What? So do you have kids who are doing that sort of thing?
Just like college. When you were in college and you're taking your basic courses, you're bored out of your gourd. So was I. I tell the story often to people to explain this. When I took college algebra, I showed up, got the syllabus, scanned it. All the way to midterm, I knew everything on there. So I told the people next to me, see you at midterm, and I left. And I didn't show up till the midterm. I took the midterm, made an A, so I've got an A in the class so far. I scan the rest of the syllabus. I know all of it. I show up at the final, make an A on the final. I made an A in college algebra. But what did I know?
You knew you were going to pay for that course.
I did pay for the course, and I paid for the book, unfortunately, because I didn't know how to play the system yet. But the bottom line is I didn't learn anything, but I got an A. So I'm an A student in a class that already knew the information. Well, our kids know that, too. That's why they get bored, just like anyone, any human being in a traditional model. So, hey, I'm going to test, and I know the first four sections of Algebra 1, so I'm going to start on Section 5. How liberating is that to a kid? I'm getting credit for what I already know, and I'm starting where I don't know it.
So let's, your digital curriculum, does it allow you to, kids to clep out? So is there a benchmark they take and they can clep out and say, okay, well, I just need to cover these objectives. I don't need these.
Yes. Yeah, and you're talking about a huge time saver. Again, your kids that get it, they already know the information. They love this model because I'm getting credit, so to speak, for what I know, and then just start where I don't.
So have you, what's the energy been like around, or just around that campus from both the students and the teacher perspective? Is everybody, I mean, Is it kind of like confused, we're still figuring it out, or like we're really excited and this is and it has it spilt over to your regular campus yet?
It has. Our students in the regular campus are ready for that to get opened up. We're not going to let anybody in at midterm just because we're trying to get culture set. So, but next spring when we do in pre-enrollment, I fully expect it to double in size. So we'll have to get 5 more teachers trained, and we'll have to get another space prepared.
So let's talk about teacher training a little bit. So, I mean, it's quite a paradigm shift, right? You know, I'm used to stage on the stage, right, and I lecture and ABC 1, 2, 3, this is how I do things. And it's a completely different way to teach. So your teachers went out to Salt Lake. I know we sent them out there for some training. What was that like for them?
I think they didn't know what they didn't know. So the first week was a real eye-opener for our faculty. They went out and observed and said, hey, this makes sense. But then when you're doing it, it is hard to let go and let a kid go. Just let them without trying to guide the whole process. And we're still struggling with that a little bit. So
yeah, it's weird because in a traditional model, there is a lot of micromanaging. Every kid, like you control.
Think about all the energy that.
And I don't mean that in a negative way. Yeah, I just mean like that's just what it is. It's what it is.
All the energy that a teacher puts forth into a lesson. So building of the lesson plan, running all the copies off for it, making sure I've got my focus question to get everybody engaged on this. How am I going to assess all this? There's a lot of energy wasted. And this is pure teaching. That's what our teachers would tell you. So our teachers don't check roll. The kids check in and out. We have an attendance secretary take care of that. There's no discipline for. We have yet to have a discipline problem in our PLC building, which people say that's insane.
That's incredible.
And I thought it was insane in Salt Lake City. They don't have discipline issues.
So why don't you have discipline issues?
I ask a student that I know very well this question. And their response was what I would think. It's what we do as adults. I said, is there people in the PLC you don't care for, or you don't get along with? Of course. How do you deal with that? I don't sit by them. And they don't sit by me. And we're in different rooms, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, because if I can work wherever I want, because it's a digital curriculum, right. I just choose to go work in the class with the teacher I like and with my friends, and then.
But if you've ever been in a class in a high school setting next to somebody you really don't care for and they don't care for you, you can wreck the whole class.
No, that's true.
So
it becomes a distraction for everybody.
For everybody. So the teachers will tell you it's pure teaching. Their energy is all student focused. And so when you remove all these other things that are pulling on teachers and just allow them to teach, that's where the joy comes. You don't get joy from check and roll. You don't get joy from writing lesson plans. There is a lot of grading involved. There's a lot of essay writing. I think the other struggle for us is how do we take this very rigorous on digital curriculum and how do we rein it in a little bit, because what we're finding, the students will tell you, is the curriculum is much more rigorous than a traditional model.
Yeah, because that's probably something else people ask a lot is, I mean, so if kids are already completing courses, this has got to be easy.
It's I looked at one particular course, and there was 170 quizzes to complete one course. So in essence, every day you're taking a quiz. You know, there's material to read, there's assignments, and then a quiz. So there's constant assessment of where they're at. And what I really appreciate is the parent is involved in the curriculum process. So our parent-teacher conferences, you sit down and we review what your student knows, not what their grade is, because the grade is irrelevant. It's what do they know? And the teacher can actually move them back into the course and say, you know what, these areas they really struggled in, so we're going to move them backwards because they need to master this. And so the parent, there's some give and take on that. So the parent, it's a two-way conversation between the teacher, parent, and then with the child. Parents are more empowered. So as a parent, I can log in right now and show you where my son is at, what lesson he is in every class, and what the topic is. So if he's asking questions at home, I can log in, I can tell you where he's at.
So every parent has the ability to log in and kind of see that.
Right.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
No, I mean, what you said is right. Like, I think about my daughter in the school she goes to. She got an assignment the other day at home that she brought home for homework, and it was like pages of work. And so I called the teacher, and I said, hey, what is this?
Like, right.
And they said, oh, well, she's just in that class. That's just terrible. So I had to find a way to get their attention. And I said, well, I kind of take exception because, you know.
So you're punishing my child because they're in a class of people that know how to behave.
Was my child acting like, you know? And no, they were fine. Okay, well, then she's being punished then, you know. Yeah. And so
our teachers will do a lot of work this summer making sure the courses are definitely the way they want them. Right now they're doing it on the fly because it's our first year with going through it. Something else we're doing is our fifth grade is doing a pilot of this in the fifth grade using the same type software. Not nearly as open, but they're doing an hour a day of personalized learning in reading and in math, and our teachers are loving it there too. So this is not just bound to high school. I guess that's my point is we're doing it at the elementary on a pilot basis, and we're already seeing, and quite honestly, it's only been a week in the making right now, but we're already seeing the benefits there as well.
That's really cool. So you spent time putting this together. You worked with the Resource Center, I know, and Carol and her team and all this, and it kind of comes together. So now you got it at the high school level, you're talking about the fifth grade level. Are there plans to move it down to the middle school level too, or is that just kind of a, hey, we need to really get settled into this first, or?
Yeah, we're going to get this going first at the high school. Quite honestly, fifth and sixth grade is an area of need for us just to differentiate the instruction. We're already seeing big gaps there. So we took our NWA data from last year, and what we found was the group that wasn't growing at all was our advanced kids. And so how do we challenge those kids? This is a model we're looking at. If it's successful there this year, then, yeah, we'll probably roll it in the middle school. And
cool. So if I am a superintendent listening, one of the things that we'll encourage them to do, obviously, is call Carol and her team and hopefully reach out to us here. But if they wanted to come out and visit your school, that's a possibility?
Oh, absolutely. We've had several through. A school in South Carolina is coming out to check out the model. Broken Arrow has made contact with us. I know they're coming here at some point in time. Mustang's been out, I believe, twice. There's a lot of schools, a lot of interest, and it's the same thing for me. I had to see it for myself, and that's what I would encourage superintendents to do is, hey, just schedule a time and just go see. And then once you see, and if we'll take the rose-colored glasses off for a minute and get away from what we know and just see what's best, I think that's where the paradigm shift is easy. If we're just concerned about student success, and you see 95% engagement, and you go to your traditional high school and you see the 50% or less, which is most high schools, it is just common sense, time on task.
That's really cool. So now that we've kind of covered all that, anything else that you feel like maybe I missed, something that...
Well, I would say this. Don't let cost be a determinant whether you do this or not. I mean, these products and things have come down so far in price. Odyssey Wear, which is the group we're working with, it is a site license, you know. So we actually are paying what we were using Odyssey Wear for our alternative ed program. And so it's benefiting just this small group of people. For the same price now, our entire campus is covered, and that's what we use in this particular model.
Great. Well, then I think we'll call that good. I appreciate you coming and
thanks
talking with us.
Out.
And so that's been our very first Oklahoma Public School Resource Center podcast, episode 1 with Dave Cash from Chickasha Schools. Thanks.